Today we're going to begin a voyage of discovery of this most extraordinary 3 pounds of jelly-like material found within each of our skulls. Now, neuroscience, as many of you know, is a discipline that employs the tools and language of anatomy, biochemistry, physiology, pharmacology, molecular biology, genetics, neurology, and psychiatry to understand the normal and pathological functioning of the nervous system. It represents a rather unique position in the curricula of the biomedical sciences in that it addresses an organ of obvious importance, the brain. What organ could be more important? But neuroscience also addresses more philosophical questions like the physiological basis of mind or emotions and our interactions with the world in which we live. It's been said that neuroscience is one of the last disciplines of the biological sciences. So when we know everything there is to know about the heart and the lungs and the kidneys, we'll still just be scratching the surface in understanding the brain. Now, this is not hopefully because people doing brain research don't have any, but rather it's because the brain is extraordinarily complex. For one, it contains more than 100 billion neurons. So that's a lot of neurons. But it's just not the number of neurons. Other organs, like the liver, have billions of liver cells. What makes the difference between the brain and the liver are two things. One is that unlike the liver, where most of the cells are doing the same thing, neurons in the brain all have specific jobs or functions. So neurons in the occipital cortex are involved in the processing of visual information. Neurons in the temporal lobe involved in memory function. Neurons in the frontal lobe involved in planning. Neurons in the cerebellum involved in balance and locomotion. Neurons in the brainstem involved in the control of respiration. So it's almost as though the brain is not a single organ. It's hundreds of different organs, each carrying out their own specific function. The other major difference between the liver and the brain is that unlike the liver, where most of the cells are doing their own thing and working in isolation, in the brain, neurons are highly connected to each other. So it's been estimated that any one neuron can receive up to 10,000 connections or messages from other neurons, and it in turn can make 10,000 connections to other neurons. So there's a whole lot of talking going on. We used to think of the brain like a computer, but it's more like a computer network with each one of those neurons being one of the individual computers. So it's those circuits that are formed by the connections among neurons that give rise to love, to charity, to Beethoven, to Shakespeare, to travel to the moon and beyond, to theories of relativity. But those circuits also give rise to hate and the ability to commit mass murder. And also, because there are so many components of the brain, there's so many things that can go wrong. Let me just introduce you to some of the things that can go wrong. And one of the things that you'll be doing as future biomedical scientists and as clinicians is to know about the things that can go wrong and know about how to fix them. So here's a brief summary of some of the major neurological disorders that we're going to talk about throughout the course. Alzheimer's disease, that's a big one that's become very prominent in the news because it's associated with loss of cognitive function and memory due to neuronal degeneration. So this is a so-called degenerative disorder, a degenerative neurological disorder, and in particular, cholinergic neurons in the central nervous system. This accounts for a prevalence right now of 5.4 million individuals, and the number is growing on a yearly basis as the population ages. Then there's epilepsy, brain seizures due to uncontrolled recruitment of electrical activity in nerve cells. 3 million people. Huntington's disease, another neurodegenerative disease associated with abnormal and voluntary movements due to the repeated mutation in the Huntington gene. Multiple sclerosis, an autoimmune disease, and there's many of these, associated with sensory and motor losses due to demyelination. Myasthenia gravis, another autoimmune disease associated with muscular weakness due to loss of acetylcholine receptors at the neuromuscular junction. Parkinson's disease, a movement disorder due to degeneration of dopamine-containing neurons, another neurodegenerative disorder, in the substantia nigral basal ganglion pathway, a brain circuit. Schizophrenia, delusions and hallucinations believed to be due to imbalances in dopamine and glutamate neurotransmitter systems. Stroke, loss of specific function due to occlusion of blood supply to specific brain regions, 4 million people. What's not indicated here, and you total these up, you have about 15 million people. What's not illustrated here is depression and anxiety, and you can add another 15 million to that. So when you add it all up, you have 10% of the population in the United States right now being afflicted with some brain disorder. Now, despite the great diversity of these disorders, there are a couple of general themes that emerge that are particularly important to pay attention to. One is there's the involvement of genes, like the mutation in the Huntington gene. There are disorders that affect neuronal properties, like myelin and synapses. There are disorders that affect neurotransmitter systems, like dopamine and acetylcholine and their receptors. And there are disorders that affect neural circuits. So the key here is that in order to understand the brain, how it functions, and how it malfunctions, you need to pay attention to the properties of individual neurons, the electrical, the biochemical, and molecular properties of individual neurons, as well as the ways in which neurons are connected to each other to form neural circuits. And that's really what's going to be the focus of this course. And the focus of this first lecture, where I'm going to give you an introduction to the basic properties of nerve cells and the basic properties of neural circuits. A good place to start is with the anatomy of a nerve cell, as shown in this illustration. So neurons are special in that they're polarized. Unlike a red blood cell, where you can't tell the top from the bottom, neurons have a distinct polarity, and they can be divided roughly into four domains, spatial domains, if you will. There is the cell body, or soma, and that's the region of the neuron where most of the general cell functions take place, right? Then extending from the soma are these tree or branch-like structures called the dendrites. It's on the dendrites where neurons receive connections, as I'll show you in a moment, from other neurons. The cell body gives rise to a long tubular structure known as the axon. It's over the axon where information, electrical activity, is propagated from one region of a nerve cell to more distant regions. That axon is in many cases covered by a thick insulating sheath known as myelin. You've heard about multiple sclerosis. That affects this, a disease that affects this myelin structure. The axon gives rise to small branches, and at the terminal region of those branches are these specialized structures called synapses. It's at the synapse where information transfer occurs between one neuron and another neuron. And the next slide illustrates one of those so-called postsynaptic neurons. So now you see two neurons. This is the beginning of the formation of a simple neural circuit. This is the beginning of the formation of a simple neural circuit. You have a presynaptic neuron and a postsynaptic neuron, right? And this postsynaptic neuron gets activated as a result of the release of a transmitter substance from the presynaptic neuron. Now, just as this is a postsynaptic neuron to this presynaptic neuron, this presynaptic neuron is a postsynaptic neuron to other neurons. So here you see three different neurons, nicely colored, red, blue, and green, that are making synaptic contacts on the dendrites of this neuron that we begin talking about. So here is a simple a three-neuron circuit, a presynaptic neuron, a postsynaptic neuron, and another postsynaptic neuron. Now, the key in understanding how these circuits work is through this specialized structure called the synapse. And here is a blow-up view of the synapse showing some of the key morphological properties of synapses. So synapses are full with these specialized structures called synaptic vesicles. It's within the vesicles where the neurotransmitter substance is located. That neurotransmitter substance is packaged in the synaptic vesicle, And when an electrical signal invades the terminal, it causes the release of those synaptic vesicles, the content, into the space between the presynaptic and the postsynaptic neuron. So here are the little molecules of neurotransmitter substance. They diffuse across the space between the presynaptic and the postsynaptic neuron, and they bind to receptors on the postsynaptic side of the membrane, where they induce permeability changes that in turn leads to a new round of potential changes in the postsynaptic neuron. Okay, so that's the basic morphology of neurons and synapses. Now, an important part about the way in which the nervous system works is through electrical signaling. And here is a cartoon that illustrates how one can record the electrical signals that are present in nerve cells. So here is an idealized version of a nerve cell. And outside, so you see the cell body and the dendrites and the axon. Outside the neuron is a device called a microelectrode. This is nothing more than a piece of glass which is stretched under heat to produce a very fine tip. The tip can be less than a micron or so in diameter. The electrode is filled with a conducting solution and connected to some device that can monitor the electrical potential, like an oscilloscope. Now, when the electrode is in the outside or the extracellular medium, there's no potential recorded on the recording device because the extracellular medium is isopotential. But if one takes this electrode and carefully inserts the tip of the electrode so that the tip is now inside the cell, there is a sharp deflection on the recording device so that now the recording device reads a potential of about minus 60 millivolts. That's 60 millivolts inside negative with respect to the outside. This is the so-called resting potential. It's actually a characteristic feature of all cells in the body. All cells in the body, including nerve cells, have a potential difference between the outside and the inside of the cell. And that potential, you'll learn much more about in this course and in physiology, is called the resting potential. And the resting potential, in the absence of any stimulation, is generally stable as long as the electrode remains in the cell and as long as there's no stimulation of the type we'll talk about in a moment. If you remove the electrode from the cell, the potential that's recorded goes back to zero. So this 60 millivolt level is the resting potential. There's nothing particularly special about minus 60. It's always about minus 60. It can be minus 65. It can be minus 55. It can be minus 75. But the universal aspect of this, the universal aspect of this is that the inside is negative with respect to the outside and about 60 millivolts in potential. Okay, so this is the resting potential. Now, what distinguishes nerve cells and other excitable membranes like muscle cells from other cells in the body is that they not only have, they not just have resting potentials, but they're also capable of changing their resting potential for the they're capable of changing their resting potential for the purpose of transmitting and propagating and processing information. So here is another simple cartoon. Here is an idealized nerve cell, and this cell has been impaled with one microelectrode to record the membrane potential. It's also been impaled with a second electrode, and this second electrode is connected up to a suitable stimulating source like a battery. And note the polarity of the battery here. The polarity of the battery is such that the positive pole is connected to this arrow, which is a switch. Now, when the switch is open, no current flows from the battery into the cell. But when the switch is closed, there will be a current flow from the battery into the cell. And what will be the consequences of closing the switch? Since the pole of the battery here is plus, it will make the inside of the cell more positive. So what we're going to see in this animation is a series of switch closures and openings with each time a different size battery placed in the circuit. We're going to start with a small battery, and then we're going to go to a larger and larger battery and look at the consequences of giving these greater and greater stimuli to the nerve cell. By the way, all these animations that I'm showing you are in your online electronic syllabus. Okay, so there is a small battery, a bigger battery, a bigger battery. Note that battery gets bigger each time, larger and larger battery, and even a larger battery. And what's interesting here is you see as you change the size of the battery, we change the size of the current, and we make the inside of the cell more and more positive. and that's called a depolarization. Depolarization, it's more positive. And within a limit, the size of those depolarizations is roughly proportional to the size of the battery until we reach a certain potential called the threshold, when a totally different type of signal is produced, and this signal is the so-called nerve action potential or impulse. So from this, you see a very important property of the action potential. You see that it's elicited in an all or none fashion. So stimuli below threshold fail to reach an action potential. Stimuli at, or in this case, above threshold, initiate an action potential. Now the duration of the stimulus here was so short that only a single action potential could be elicited. But if we use a longer duration stimuli, we see that longer duration stimuli elicit a greater number of action potentials, with each action potential having the same all or nothing amplitude. So here's four panels. And what we're going to see in each one of these panels is a switch closure, and each panel is associated with a larger battery. So here's a very small battery, and here's a very big battery, right? You have different size batteries, 1.5-volt battery, 9-volt battery, 12-volt battery, and so forth. So the larger the battery, the larger will be the depolarization of the nerve cell. So here's a small battery. And you can hear the sound of the electricity in the animation. So this is a small battery, and you see that it depolarized the cell, but threshold was not reached. You try a larger battery, a somewhat larger battery. Now we trigger an action potential, but just one action potential. Sorry about the sound, it's kind of corny. Okay. Here's a bigger battery. Three action potentials, and here's an even bigger battery. A whole bunch of action potentials. The key point here, there's two very important points here. One is that the greater the magnitude of the stimulus, the greater is the number or frequency of action potentials. That's called frequency coding of the nervous system. And it's a very general phenomenon. The greater the intensity of a stimulus to the skin, the greater the number of action potentials that are propagated to the central nervous system, telling you about the intensity of a touch. The greater the stretch of a muscle, the greater the number of action potentials that are sent to the spinal cord. The greater the intensity of illumination to the eye, the greater the number of action potentials that will be sent to the central nervous system. And the same thing works, the same principle works on the motor side of the system. The greater the number of action potentials in a motor neuron, the greater will be the strength of a muscular contraction. So this is called the principle of frequency coding in the nervous system. You'll note when the stimulus intensity is larger, it's not that the size of the action potential changes. Each action potential has the identical size. It's rather that the number or frequency of action potentials changes. Okay, now, with that very brief introduction into the anatomy and physiology of nerve cells, we can start to talk about how nerve cells are connected to each other. And there's two basic flavors of the ways in which neurons talk to each other. There's a so-called excitatory connection, and there's a so-called inhibitory connection. So let's talk about the excitatory connection first, because it's the most obvious. So here's a cartoon of two neurons, a presynaptic neuron, this one nicely colored, coded in green. And we're going to call this an excitatory neuron for reasons that will become clear in a moment. And that neuron is making a synaptic contact with a postsynaptic neuron, this blue one. And we're making intracellular recordings, as shown below here, from both the postsynaptic neuron, that's the blue trace here, and the green excitatory neuron. Now, at this point in time, an action potential is initiated in the excitatory neuron. We don't have to worry for the moment how that was initiated, perhaps through an intracellular injection of current or perhaps by some sensory stimulus. But what you see here, importantly, is the action potential in the presynaptic neuron, and as a consequence of that action potential, there is a potential change in the postsynaptic neuron. And this potential is a depolarization. The membrane potential has become less negative. Such a potential is called an excitatory postsynaptic potential. Excitatory, because it depolarizes the cell, bringing the cell towards threshold. And postsynaptic, for obvious reasons, it's a potential recorded on the postsynaptic side of the synapse. Now, in most cases, a single action potential in the presynaptic neuron, while it produces a depolarization of the postsynaptic neuron, that depolarization is insufficiently large to reach threshold and trigger an action potential in the postsynaptic neuron. But if two of those action potentials are fired in quick succession, the EPSP produced by the second action potential adds to the EPSP produced by the first action potential, and now that summated EPSP is capable of reaching threshold and firing an action potential in the postsynaptic neuron. So now, with this simple circuit, we have allowed one neuron to activate another neuron, and that's a go signal, if you will, in a very simplistic manner, for propagating information through this circuit. Okay, let's talk about that other flavor of synaptic transmission. This is the inhibitory synaptic transmission. So the top, you see the same excitatory neuron that we talked about earlier. The bottom now shows this red neuron, which, for obvious reasons, we'll soon see is called an inhibitory neuron. Now, the first part of this panel is identical to what I showed you previously. An EPSP produced by the excitatory neuron by a single action potential produces a subthreshold EPSP. Two together produce this summating EPSP, leading to an action potential. So here's the inhibitory interneuron. Now we produce an action potential in the inhibitory neuron, and what do you see in the postsynaptic cell is that the membrane potential becomes more hyperpolarized, more negative, which is called a hyperpolarization as opposed to a depolarization. So as a result of the chemical transmitter substance released here, the membrane potential of the postsynaptic cell becomes more negative. What's the functional consequence of that? Well, when you just look at this, you see, well, it doesn't do anything. The neuron wasn't firing any action potentials to begin with, and is still not firing any action potentials because of the IPSP, inhibitory postsynaptic potential. This is called an EPSP, or excitatory postsynaptic potential. So what good are these IPSPs? Somebody is saying they reduce the probability of initiating an action potential. Absolutely correct. And you see that. You see that when you challenge the system with a combination of excitatory and inhibitory input. So the IPSP, it hyperpolarizes the cell, decreases the probability of the postsynaptic cell from firing. Now here is, you see, this process of integration. Here was the IPSP produced by the red neuron. Now you have another action potential in the red neuron producing the IPSP, but shortly thereafter you produce the same two action potentials in the excitatory neuron that you produced over here. Over here, these two action potentials produced EPSPs that summated to reach threshold and produce an action potential. Over here, the two EPSPs summate, but because of the simultaneous inhibition, now the summation fails to reach threshold, and the postsynaptic neuron does not fire an action potential. So this inhibitory neuron can regulate, it can regulate the ability of the excitatory neuron to drive the postsynaptic neuron. Or, as was said by one of the students, it can regulate the probability of the postsynaptic neuron being active. Okay, now let's talk about micro-network motifs. Fancy word, but all it means is that despite the tens of thousands of different ways neurons can connect with each other, there's a certain number of common motifs that occur very frequently in neural circuits used by the nervous system. And what I've illustrated here is some of those common motifs that you're going to be seeing over and over again throughout the course. Let me just give you a very brief introduction to them, and then we'll talk about some of them in more detail. So here is feedforward excitation. We've already seen that. One neuron excites a postsynaptic neuron. Here is a circuit called feedforward inhibition. And this diagram, by the way, The green cells are ones that have excitatory effects. The red cells have inhibitory effects. So this one's called feedforward inhibition. An excitatory neuron activates this red neuron, and this red neuron, in turn, inhibits the neuron that it's connected to. Seems kind of odd, and we'll see how this actually works in a real circuit. And then there's this phenomenon of convergence and divergence. And it simply is a restatement of what I told you about the basic connectivity patterns. So here you see one postsynaptic neuron receiving connections from three different neurons. So these three different neurons are converging on the same postsynaptic neuron. So here is convergence, and here is divergence. One individual presynaptic neuron connects to many different postsynaptic neurons. Here's a circuit called lateral inhibition. An excitatory neuron connects or excites an inhibitory neuron, and that inhibitory neuron, in turn, it feeds back to inhibit adjacent neurons to the first one that was active. I'll show you more details of this in a moment. Here's an interesting circuit called feedback or recurrent inhibition. An excitatory neuron activates a postsynaptic neuron. The postsynaptic neuron activates an inhibitory neuron that makes an inhibitory connection onto the neuron that was first activated. Does anybody see a possible function for this, just thinking about it? It's kind of like a braking mechanism. This neuron gets active. The postsynaptic neuron gets active. The postsynaptic neuron feeds back and says, hold on, I don't want you to be active anymore. I had enough. So this is a braking mechanism. Once you start this thing going, it comes back and turns it off. Here's an interesting circuit. Look at this one. An inhibitory neuron connects to an inhibitory neuron, which connects to another inhibitory neuron, which connects to another inhibitory interneuron, which connects back to itself. What could this possibly do? We'll see in a moment. And then there's, just like there's feedback or recurrent inhibition, there's feedback or recurrent excitation. And what do you think intuitively this kind of circuit can do? It's a switch. Once this neuron is active, the postsynaptic neuron is active, which then feeds back to activate the neuron that started it all. So once you get this thing going, it will go on and on forever, in principle. So this is a switch. And switches are really important in some cases in the nervous system, because you'd like to have some of your neurons switching on right now, the neurons that are involved in memory mechanisms, so you can remember this lecture tomorrow. So let's talk about some of these in more detail. Let's talk about the feedforward excitation and feedforward inhibition, and this is particularly relevant to what you just heard from Dr. Oakes. So here is the stretch reflex, the monosynaptic reflex that Dr. Oakes talked about. Because it's called the monosynaptic reflex because it involves a single synapse in the spinal cord. It's actually a little more complicated, but basically it can be boiled down to that. So here's that neurologist hammer that Dr. Oakes talked about. The hammer taps the tendon, stretches the tendon, activates receptors, stretch receptors. Those stretch receptors initiate action potentials, indicated by these little circles. The action potentials then propagate to the central nervous system, to the spinal cord, where they produce a feed-forward excitatory connection onto this blue neuron. That neuron becomes active. Action potentials propagate out the ventral root to cause the contraction of the skeletal muscle, and here's the subsequent reflex. This would be a grade 2 reflex based on your chart. Simple monosynaptic reflex involving a feed-forward excitation circuit. Now, what you also see here is another interesting circuit motif that we've talked about. Look at this neuron here, which is called an interneuron, this black one. Now, an interneuron is called an interneuron because it's interposed between one neuron and another neuron. So here, the interneuron is interposed between this blue sensory excitatory neuron and this red motor neuron, which happens to be a flexor motor neuron, right? Extensor motor neuron, flexor motor neuron. Note that with this reflex, we activate the extensor motor neuron. Isn't that what you want to do, to have the reflex? And this is, by the way, as was indicated, this is a simple way of assessing the integrity of the nervous system with this simple reflex test, all right? So It tells us how well information is being propagated here. It tells us something about synaptic transmission. It tells us about the motor synapse here in the muscle cell. So one can glean a lot of information about the integrity of our nervous system just by using this simple reflex and others. Okay, the neuron, the presynaptic neuron here, the green one, excites the interneuron. The interneuron releases the neurotransmitter producing an IPSP in the flexor motor neuron. Why do you want to inhibit the flexor motor neuron? Because you want to get the extension, you want to decrease the probability of having this neuron being active and producing an inappropriate contraction, right? So this feed-forward inhibition is a way of regulating neural circuits. Let's talk about convergence and divergence using, again, the spinal circuit. So here is the very simplified version of the basic circuit. The sensory neuron connects to the extensor motor neuron. It also connects to the inhibitory interneuron, which in this case would inhibit the flexor motor neuron. It's more complicated than that, is that the sensory neuron just doesn't connect to one motor neuron, one extensor motor neuron. It connects to many different extensor motor neurons. So this is the principle of divergence. And here's the principle of convergence. Any one motor neuron doesn't just receive synaptic connections from a single sensory neuron. It receives synaptic connections from many different sensory neurons. So it's this combination of convergence and divergence that really makes this reflex work. It's not just that one synapse. It's a whole bunch of synapses. Okay, let's talk about lateral inhibition. Lateral inhibition is a very important circuit that mediates a phenomenon called edge enhancement. And what I mean by that is shown in this little panel here, showing two rectangles, a dark one and a lighter one, next to each other. Now, if you look at this carefully, I can tell you in advance that the illumination here, the intensity of the illumination, is totally uniform throughout, and the intensity for the darker rectangle, and it's totally uniform throughout for the lighter rectangle. But if you look closely at the border between these two rectangles, you may notice that at the border of the darker rectangle, it seems a little bit darker than the rest of the rectangle. And at the border of the light rectangle with the dark rectangle, it seems a little bit lighter here than it does throughout the rest of the rectangle. So this is does everybody see that? This is not a trick. This is totally the same illumination here and here. So this is edge enhancement. This allows us to detect edges. And that can be really important if you're walking at night near a cliff. You want to make sure you know where the edge is, right? So edge enhancement. Now, how does this work? This simple circuit of lateral inhibition allows us to make this distinction. And here's a very simple cartoon of how it works. So here's the dark rectangle. Here's the light rectangle. Now, and here is a very simple description of the circuitry in the retina. So we have light impinging on photoreceptors. And as a result of the light, the photoreceptors become active and initiate action potentials. Those photoreceptors, in turn, make synaptic connections to so-called second-order neurons. And those neurons then transmit information to the central nervous system, right? And the assumption here is, so these fives, see the 5-5-5 and 10-10-10, that's just a reflection of the intensity of illumination. Let's just say this is 5 lumens here, and the brighter structure is 10 lumens, right? So because you have 5 lumens, we're going to make a very simple assumption that an intensity of light of 5 lumens produces action potentials of 5 hertz, or 5 per second, right? So 5 per second here, 5 per second here, 5 per second here, and the neurons that are activated by the brighter intensity stimulus to the retina then fire more action potentials. So 10 lumens, this is a great simplification, fire 10 action potentials per second. So if this was all there was to the circuit without lateral inhibition, what you would perceive is exactly what is presented to the eye, right? This is dark. And this is bright. And there's no difference at the edge. Now, with lateral inhibition, things change. So here's the lateral inhibition. Each one of these retinal receptors makes an inhibitory connection to adjacent downstream second-order neurons. The connection is weak, as indicated by this point 2. The normal excitatory connection is plus 1. The inhibitory connection is minus 2. So each one of these neurons makes an inhibitory connection to its neighbor. That's the lateral inhibition. Now, note the consequences of this. Over here, away from the edge, the 5 intensity of illumination now produces fewer action potentials because there's some inhibition from the neighbor. But it's still 3 here and 3 here, right? That's fine. And the neurons that are responding to the brighter illumination, they are still firing at a constant rate. It's somewhat reduced, 6 and 6. But the real interesting thing occurs here at the edge, because now the neuron that is receiving the illumination at the edge receives less inhibition from this neuron at the edge, and therefore its output is greater because it's getting less inhibition from its partner over here. And this neuron, which is responding to the dim illumination, is receiving more inhibition from its neighbor to the right in the bright region. So the net consequence is that the neuron that's responding here is firing less than its partners, and the neuron that's responding here is responding more, giving a perceived light difference at the edge. Think about this. It's not intuitively obvious, but if you work through the numbers, I think it will become clear. Now, lateral inhibition is great because it provides us with this edge enhancement. But it also has a problem, and it leads to a so-called visual illusion. And there's one very famous visual illusion called Mach bands. You've probably all seen this again. So here what we see is a gradient of illumination. See, it's bright, dark, bright, dark, bright, dark, bright, dark, right throughout? It's all obvious. And also what you see here is a horizontal stripe. And you'll note with this horizontal stripe that it appears to change in illumination. It's dark here, it's bright here, dark here, bright here. Does everybody see that? Well, you're all seeing an illusion because it's the exact intensity here as it is here. And you can see that by putting a mask over this. So you don't see this anymore, you just see the horizontal bar. Here we go, here's the mask. And of course, there's no tricks here. There's the mask. It's the exact same intensity. So you've all been tricked. And this shows that what you think you see is what sometimes is not really there. This is just a simple illusion. How does this work? So the property of lateral inhibition explains this. Why is this dark here? This region is perceived as being dark here because the neurons that are responding to this intensity in the retina have neighbors that are responding to a bright light. So they are inhibited by their neighbors. And why is this appear to be darker here? Because this region is dark, so these neurons are inhibiting the neurons responding to the band less so, right? So there is your visual illusion. And just as the lateral inhibition can explain edge enhancement, it can also explain this very ubiquitous visual illusion. Let's talk about feedback or recurrent inhibition. And before I talk about it in terms of a neural network or a micro network, I want to talk about it in terms of a so-called nano network. So there's 3 levels of networks that we're going to be talking about. A micro network, that's these types involving a small number of cells. A nano network involving biochemical reactions in networks. And finally, macro networks that involve large connections or collections of micro networks. So a nano network of feedback inhibition is important for producing a phenomenon as shown here. Now, the standard textbook version of neurons is either they are silent or they fire action potentials when they are stimulated with a synaptic input. But some neurons, like this one, have a so-called endogenous bursting behavior. So in the absence of any input, this neuron is firing bursts of action potentials, becoming silent, firing bursts of action potentials again, and becoming silent. So this is called an endogenous bursting activity. These kinds of activity patterns could be important for rhythmic behavior, like respiration. Well, how is it that we breathe in and out?
this kind of neuron could be responsible for those kinds of rhythmic behaviors. How does this work? This works through a nano circuit. Here is an idealized version of that neuron, the outside of the cell, the inside of the cell. These cells have specialized channels that allow for calcium influx to occur. Calcium is a positively charged ion. It's at high concentration outside, low concentration inside. The feedback inhibition network, and I want to compare this network with this network. So the calcium comes in, and when calcium comes in, it depolarizes the cell. And as it depolarizes the cell, it brings the cell to threshold, causing the initiation of action potentials. But the interesting part here is that the increase in calcium also reduces the conductance of this channel to allow calcium inflow to occur, so the calcium inflow stops. But that calcium then, which is inhibiting the inflow of calcium, then is taken up by buffers, and so the calcium concentration is reduced, allowing the influx of calcium to occur again and repeating the cycle. So the point that I'm trying to make here is that this type of feedback inhibition circuit is capable of generating an oscillatory behavior. An oscillatory behavior in a neuron and an oscillatory behavior in a nerve circuit. This is a relatively short-lasting type of phenomena, short-term dynamics, once every 10 to 15 seconds. There is a subcellular network that's due to feedback inhibition that underlies 24-hour rhythms. And the big 24-hour rhythm that you all know about is the circadian rhythm. Circadian rhythms are due to oscillations produced in a special part of the brain called the suprachiasmatic nucleus. It's located just above the optic nerve. And what the suprachiasmatic nucleus does is it generates rhythmic patterns of output. And those rhythmic patterns of output have widespread effects on the release of hormones from the pineal gland, melatonin, regulation of the autonomic nervous system, the daily cycle of our body temperature, regulation of hormonal release. Now, it's interesting that this very complex and profound phenomenon can really be boiled down to a simple feedback inhibition circuit among one gene. So there's a gene called PER, and PER leads to the synthesis of the PER message and, in turn, the PER protein. PER protein then feeds back to inhibit the transcription of the gene. And this inhibitory cycle has a time course of about 24 hours. So the protein is made, it then inhibits the cycle, the protein is degraded, relieving the inhibition, allowing the cycle to happen again, making more protein, inhibiting the transcription, the protein is degraded, then the cycle repeats itself over and over again in a 24-hour period. Remember that crazy circuit with the four inhibitory neurons inhibiting each other? Well, that can explain, at least in principle, quadrupedal locomotion. So here's a little doggy showing the pattern of a walk. It's a gait, so-called gait, right? And a walk is associated with a movement of the left front limb, and a quarter of a cycle later, the right hind limb, and then half cycle later, the right front, and then the left hind. So the question is, how can this kind of gait be produced by the nervous system? Can a simple circuit do it? Another secondary question is that animals can do more than just walk. As shown over here, they can also trot. A trot is a gait associated with a in-phase movements of the left front and the right hind, and with 180 degrees out of phase of the opposite limbs. But they can also do something called a bound, where the two front limbs are in phase and 180 degrees out of phase with the rears. And then there's something like a gallop, which is very similar to a bound. So we don't understand the neural circuits that produce these, but let's think about ways in which, in principle, you could do it. Is all the dogs? You can get these animations online. So one way you could do it is as follows. Remember that endogenous bursting neuron? You could take four of those endogenous bursting neurons and have one neuron hooked up to the left front limb, another hooked up to the left hind limb, and so forth. And if you set up the timing just right, so you put these two guys in phase with each other, and these guys' hind limbs 180 degrees out of phase with the first two, you could, in principle, produce a gallop. These two limbs would go first, and then would be followed half a cycle later by the hind limbs. Right? In theory, it would work, but in practice, there'd be problems because, one is you'd have to set these up so they're exactly in phase, right, like this. And what would happen if there was some drift in the activity. So this one started firing a little bit earlier or later. Well, your problem would be that things would get very uncoordinated. So this doggy is not going to gallop. In fact, it's not even going to walk very well. So one way you could do this is with this circuit here. You take now four of these neurons, and each one becomes a bursting neuron. And when you do that, you get a circuit like this. And if you do a simple twist of the circuit, shown here, it's the same circuit. This blue one, that was that green one down here, is now up here. Now, this circuit, with just those four neurons, with those endogenous bursting properties, can produce each of those four different gallops with slight modifications in the strength of the synaptic connections between the neurons. So here's an example where this relatively simple circuit can, at least in principle, produce a fairly complex behavior, which gives us hope for understanding more complex behaviors in the nervous system. Here's a circuit I'm not going to go into. You can read about it. This is a circuit for the recurrent feedback excitation. This is important in the hippocampus. That's a region of the brain important in memory mechanisms where the memory is distributed among the strength of the synaptic connections. And then finally, we have macro circuits. All these different of the brain, regions of the brain are highly interconnected to each other. And within each one of these regions are microcircuits, but this microcircuit is communicating with another microcircuit over here. And collectively, these circuits form something that looks like this. This is a macro circuit for the processing of visual information. You need to commit this to memory. No, I'm only joking. But just to illustrate the point of how complicated things are. So here, down here, processing of information from the retinal ganglion cells to the lateral geniculate up to various visual cortical areas. All these different cortical areas are communicating with each other through feed-forward and feedback connections.
We've given you a brief introduction to the properties of neurons and neural circuits. What you're going to learn about next in the lecture from Dr. Byrne is how these circuits are formed. How do they form in development, and how is it possible that one neuron can be specifically wired and connected to its appropriate partner? Okay, thank you.